Thank you much, Paul, for that wonderful, wonderful song. I enjoy the ministry of a harmonica. You don't hear many of them anymore. Paul's a great player of harmonica. He plays in the church, plays with Straightway, a group here in our area. Does a fine job. And I appreciate him and Dad coming down to the church and making these presentations so we could put them in with the preaching and so we could have some music and the preaching. But today I want you to take your Bible and turn with me to 1 Peter 3, verses 18 to 22. And I want to bring a very unique message. Probably many listening to my voice, you've never heard of what we're going to preach on today. It's been a long time in my Christian life before I ever heard about this. I'd often wondered about it, but what happened to Jesus during the period between his death and his resurrection? We know he died at 3 o'clock on Friday, and he rose before 6 o'clock on Sunday. And we know that he was buried in the rich man's tomb, Joseph of Arimathaea. So what was he doing? Well, we know his body is dead, but was his spirit? I mean, for you and for me and for all Christians, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. The body will die, but the spirit never dies. And the spirit of Jesus would never die either. And so what was he doing during this busy time? We're going to look at it today, this being Saturday. This would be the day that he would have done what we're going to describe. He actually went and preached to the spirits in prison, the demons who were in a demon dungeon. And it was a message of victory. They had tried their best to stop Jesus from what he was going to do. And before we get started, I always kind of like to give something funny. I heard about a family. They invited the pastor over for Sunday dinner, and after the prayer, they're all digging into that very fine meal. And the pastor said, "My, my, what wonderful, lovely meat this is. I'm a meat eater, and this is delicious." Little Johnny said, "That's skunk." Preacher said, "What?" He said, "Yes, that's skunk meat." So Mom and Dad kind of blushed and told Johnny to be quiet. But Johnny insisted, "It is skunk, Mom. I heard you tell Daddy yesterday that you were having that old skunk for dinner." I hope you wouldn't talk about the preacher, huh? But we come to a very interesting portion of Scripture here in 1 Peter 3, verses 18 through 20. It says, "For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit, by which also he went and preached to the spirits in prison, which sometimes were disobedient, when once the long suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a preparing, wherein few, that is, eight souls, were saved by water. The like figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us, not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience towards God, by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who is gone into heaven and is on the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers being made subject unto him." Let's go to prayer and ask God's blessings upon our time in the Word today. Father, thank you for those listening by the means of modern technology through this internet. I ask you blessings upon them wherever they might be. I know it's been a very trying time for all of us, and we pray protection, that you will just protect us from this virus, comfort those who have lost loved ones, heal those who are sick, bring us back safely to our church families once again. And I pray that it be soon. We miss our church. We miss our church family. And so we just pray for everyone out there today listening to the sound of my voice. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, one of the great themes you see in the Bible, of course, is the death of Christ. He was our substitute. He died an atoning death for us. And so I want to look at that today, the substitutionary death for our sins. But I want to go a little bit deeper than that into what happened during the 3 days when he was in the tomb. Now, we know his body was dead, but was his spirit dead also? Or was he alive in spirit? And if so, what was he doing? What was he doing during this time that his body is lying in the tomb of Joseph? We know Joseph of Arimathaea came and took the body and put it in his own tomb. So some interesting questions that this passage in Peter is going to shed some light upon. Number one, we see the death of Christ, and that's described here in 1 Peter 3, verse number 18. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. I mean, we think about suffering that he has already endured at the hands of these Romans. And all of this suffering that he has done on that cross for 6 hours, that shows us the love of Christ and all the suffering that he did so that we could be forgiven of our sins. But now Peter wants to encourage his readers who are actually suffering. Peter writes this epistle to suffering Christians. And during his day, there were Christians thrown to the lions, and there were Christians lit as lampposts down the city of the streets of Rome with tar, and then they were lit and burned to death. This was a time of great sacrifice for Christians. Look at the catacombs. You'll see the burial grounds for many a martyr, those who died for Christ. And all the Old Testament had pointed towards this day that Jesus would die on the cross, as we looked at yesterday. And so these sacrifices in the Old Testament, they could never remove sin. They could only cover sin. But Christ could wash our sins as white as snow. So we see here in this passage, in verse number 18, Christ once suffered for sins. That tells us it'll never have to be repeated again. Once was enough. And the word suffer in the Greek language means to be afflicted and to experience a very sad and a bad plight. And so we know that Christ was afflicted for us. He did experience a terrible death. And then as Christ suffered so sadly for us, certainly that was a bad plight. He had never experienced sin, but now he has taken your sins and my sins upon himself. And then it goes on to say, the just dies for the unjust. Who is that? Jesus is the just. He is the sinless one. He is the perfect one. Amen. He never one time broke any of God's laws. He never thought anything bad, never did any bad deed. He was the law of God in the flesh. And that word just means equitable. It means holy one, righteous one. So we could say Jesus was innocent, holy, just, righteous. He was qualified to be our substitute. I could not die for you, neither could you die for me. Why? We're all in the same boat. We have all sinned and come short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23 says. The word for unjust there that carries the idea of sinful, unrighteous, wicked and treacherous, the heathen. And that's really what we were, if we'd admit it, before we came to Christ and were saved. In the sight of a holy God, we were unjust, wicked, treacherous, unrighteous, but thanks be unto God for that unspeakable gift of giving Jesus Christ as our Savior. The just died for the unjust. The righteous died for the unrighteous. The innocent died for the guilty. Jesus died for you and for me. Why? He was the perfect Lamb of God who never, ever sinned. Not one time. And so he was willing to be our sacrifice. Most people would die maybe for a loved one, but not many would die for their enemies. But Jesus died for us even when we were running from him and we were enemies of God. He is a mediator between God and man. He brings mankind back to God the Father through his sacrifice. So in verse number 18 here in 1 Peter chapter 3, notice what it says. It says here that the just dies for the unjust. Why? So he can bring us back to God. I mean, through Adam and Eve, we were separated from God. We were alienated from God, but through the death of Christ, now we're brought back into a right relationship with God. Then it says he was put to death in the flesh. That was done through crucifixion, but in reality, he gave his life. They didn't take his life. Listen to Luke 23:46. Luke 23:46. Here's what it says. When Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he's on the cross now, he said, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit." And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. That means he gave his life. He died voluntarily. No one took it from him. Now back to 1 Peter 3:18. Christ suffered for the sins, the just for the unjust. Why? So he could bring us back to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. When Christ Jesus died, the Spirit quickened him. The word for quickened in the Greek language simply means to make alive, to give life back. And so the Holy Spirit of God gave life back into Jesus after the 3 days lying in that tomb. And because Jesus rose from the dead, we also are going to rise from the dead. Our loved ones are going to rise from the dead. And friends, if we are alive when he comes back in the clouds, called the rapture of the church, we won't die. I've often said, I'm not looking for the undertaker. I'm looking for the upper taker. And he'll come, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain are going to be caught up together with them in the clouds to be with the Lord. We'll have a glorified body just like he has. But notice the second thing, the preaching of Christ. The preaching of Christ. Notice verse 19 there, by which also, 1 Peter 3:19, Jesus, he went and preached unto the spirits in prison. Now it says that during this time between his death and his resurrection, he went and preached to the spirits in prison. Now his body is dead and it's in the grave, but his spirit is alive and doing well. And with that spirit, Jesus literally goes and preaches to demons. It's called a demon dungeon. There's two kinds of demons mentioned in the Bible. Some can roam around, and some people are possessed with demons. Jesus healed many of them. There are other demons that are bound to a demon dungeon, chained with some kind of a supernatural chain, and they cannot get out. They cannot go about and possess people. And so we're going to talk a little bit about why that is, two kinds of demons. So the word for preached, he went and preached to the demons in prison. The word for preach there means to herald. It's a message of victory, a herald of triumph. And this was not just a message of salvation. For the angelic world and the demonic world, they're already in a fixed state. Since Satan rebelled against God, Revelation tells us 1/3 of the angels sided in with Satan and they became demons. 2/3 of the angels remained faithful to God and they are holy angels. And there are some demons that are chained in this demon dungeon, and there are some demons that can roam about and possess human beings. And Jesus cast out many demons in his earthly ministry, and one day all demons and Satan himself is going to be chained in this demon dungeon. But for now, there's only a part of them that are chained. In Luke chapter number 8, the Bible said Jesus cast the demons out of the maniac of Gadara. I mean, when he was confronted, these demons begged Jesus not to cast them into the deep or that demon dungeon. And Jesus allowed them to go into a herd of swine or pigs. They knew that he could cast them into that demon dungeon, and they asked him not to do it. And listen to what it says in Luke chapter 8, verse 30 to 32. And Jesus answered him, saying, "What is thy name?" And he said, "Legion," because many devils were entered into him, or demons. And the legion's around 70. I don't know if the man had that many, but he calls himself a legion. could have had 70 demons in this man. And these demons besought him, Jesus, that he would not command them to go out into the deep. And there was there a herd of swine feeding on that mountain. And so they besought Jesus, begged him that he would suffer or allow them to enter into these swine. And he suffered or allowed it. And there's another instance where demons asked Jesus not to send them to a demon prison before their time. Listen to Matthew 8, verse number 29. And behold, they cried out, and they said, these are demons now, "What have we to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of God? Art thou come hither to torment us?" Notice, before the time. Are you come to throw us in the demon dungeon before it's actually our time to go? Friends, one day out in the future, Jesus will cast all demons in a demon dungeon along with Satan and the Antichrist and the false prophet. But as you go back to the Gadarene maniac, he was chained and all the demons were so strong they couldn't even keep him chained. He ran through the tombs, cut himself, broke the chains. Everybody's scared to death of that man. But when he sees Jesus, he falls down and these demons ask him, "Can we go in those pigs?" And Jesus allowed it. And they went over the cliff and down into the water of the Sea of Galilee and they drowned. And that is the first instance of deviled ham in history. Just kidding there. But friends, listen to what the Bible tells us. Matthew 25 verse 41. "Then shall he say unto them on his left hand," Jesus talking to those on his left hand, "Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared," notice who it's prepared for, "the devil and his angels." Who are the devil's angels? They're demons. But until that day, some are already bound and some of them are free to roam the earth. Now, who are these demons that Jesus went and preached to in this demon prison? Well, we got to go back to 1 Peter chapter 3 now, verse number 20. Hang with me here. 1 Peter 3, verse number 20, "When sometime they were disobedient." What time was that? Well, it was when the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, when he was preparing the ark, wherein there were only 8 souls saved by the water, or from the water. And that was 120 years during the days of Noah. He preached and only his family were saved. And so these are some demons that did something during that period of time while Noah is preparing the ark for 120 years. They're disobedient during Noah's day. Peter gives us another insight into this event when these demons were bound in 2 Peter chapter number 2 and verse number 4. 2 Peter 2, 4 says this, "For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment, and then he spared not the old world, but he saved Noah, the 8th person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly." There again, we see their fallen angels. They're demons who had sinned during the days of Noah. They did something so horrific that God made sure they would never be able to do it again. So God cast them down into hell. The word for hell there, Tartaru in the Greek language, simply means they're incarcerated in eternal torment. They're cast into hell and held by some kind of a chain. The place called Tartarus seems to be a place where hell is located. A demon dungeon is there. And so, by the way, the word hell, notice in verse number 4, literally Tartarus is from the Greek mythology, and they would use that word to describe subterranean abyss in which rebellious gods were punished. So the word was taken over into Judaism, and it was used to refer to a prison of fallen demons. It is said, by the way, in the non-biblical book, the book of Enoch, of course, it's not inspired by God, but it's a book that was written between Malachi and Matthew, one of those apocryphal books, the book of Enoch, and it talked about that. And the Jews were very familiar with the book of Enoch. And Jude, in his epistle, he even made reference to the book of Enoch. The book of Enoch discusses the Genesis account of these angels who overstepped their boundaries. So I believe that Peter, in 1st and 2nd Peter, he is referring to something that would have been commonly known by the people of their day, as they had already read about it in the book of Enoch. Again, not a biblical book, but it was a book that people read during that day. So Peter in 2 Peter 2:4 is saying that God took these angels who sinned during the days of Noah, and he put them in the murky abyss of fallen angels, a prison for the demons. Now Jude, the half-brother of Jesus, Jude in the book of Jude, verses 6 and 7, gives us a little insight into this. That's why you have to kind of look at Scripture. The best commentary on Scripture is Scripture. Now listen to Jude, verses 6 and 7. And the angels which kept not their first estate, but they left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day, even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves, notice what they did, they gave themselves over to fornication or sexual sin, going after strange flesh, and are set forth for an example, the suffering, the vengeance of eternal fire. These fallen angels or demons had left their own habitation and had given themselves over to fornication, going after strange flesh. And so as a result of their disobedience, God chained them in darkness so they could never do those dastardly acts again. Now, what happened during the days of Noah's flood that would have involved demons? And what exactly was the sin these demons committed that was so bad that God had to chain them with a supernatural chain that would hold and bind them in a demon dungeon forever? Well, for the answer, you have to look back to Genesis chapter 6, which describes the days of Noah. Mankind had rebelled against God to the point that God had to destroy the whole human race, with the exception of one family, Noah's family. And whatever happened was so wicked and terrible that it repented God and it grieved him at his heart. The word repent means to change his course of action. God has never sinned. He doesn't have to repent of sin, but he has repented. He has changed his course of action, and he did so when he had Noah's flood. He wiped mankind completely off the earth and started all over again with Noah, his wife, his three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, and their wives. Now, what happened was so horrific, it caused God to start the whole human race again. Well, we'll read it in Genesis chapter 6, verse 1 through 7. It says, it came to pass during these days when Noah is building this ark, men began to multiply in Genesis 6, 1, on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto these men. And notice verse 2, the sons of God, these are angels, they saw the daughters of men that they were fair, pretty. And so they took them wives of all they chose. And the Lord said, uh-oh, demons mixing with women? My spirit shall not always strive with man, for he also is flesh, yet his days are going to be 120 years. And then in verse 4 it says there were even giants in those earth in those days. And also after that, when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, these angels coming into the daughters of men, they bare children to them. And their offspring became mighty men of old, men of renown. Verse 5, notice Genesis chapter 6, verse 5. God saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart were only evil continually. And it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, and all the creeping things and the fowls of the air. For it repented me that I have made them. Friends, when Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden, God expelled them out of the garden, and he gave them a promise that from the seed of the woman there would come one who would be the Savior of the world. You can read about it in Genesis 3, verse number 15. By the way, it is the very first promise of Christmas in the Bible that Jesus would come down through the seed of the woman. Notice what it says in Genesis 3:15. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Now, at first glance, it seems to describe a natural hatred mankind has for snakes. How many of you like snakes? I doubt very many of you do. There might be some. I've met some who had snakes for pets. But there was one time I brought some snakes home. They were little ringneck snakes. And I put them in an aquarium. I didn't know they could go up the side of glass. And I must have had 20 or 30 of these little small snakes in that aquarium. I was so proud of them. I put some food and some, you know, grass and all in that aquarium. And the next morning, I didn't have a lid on the aquarium because I didn't know they could crawl out. And the next morning, I got up and looked down to feed them, and they were all gone. And they're all in the house. And friends, we found those snakes for weeks. That was the end of my snake career right there. Dad said, no more snakes in the house. I said, amen to that. But here we have a scripture, and it looks like he's talking about the hatred that man has had for snakes. You know, he'll stomp his head, but he could also be bitten in his heel from stomping the snake. But when you investigate this scripture a little bit deeper, we're going to see this is a verse predicting that Jesus would come from the seed of the woman and that he would crush the head of the serpent or Satan when he comes, in the process of defeating Satan and crushing the head of Satan, Jesus would suffer a heel wound, and that would be the cross. He did suffer a wound. He did crush the head of Satan, but he suffered a heel wound in the process on the cross of Calvary. So when that prediction was made, Satan must have heard it as well. He knew about this, and so he would do whatever he could to stop the coming Messiah from ever being born of the seed of the woman. And Satan would be doomed if this happened. And so the theory behind what happened here in Genesis 6 is that Satan had some of his demons intermixed with the daughters of men, so the bloodline would be so corrupt that they could never produce the coming Messiah. Satan tried his best to corrupt the human bloodline, but all to no avail, because God preserved that lineage that would eventually bring birth to Jesus through the family of Noah. Even though these sons of God, who were fallen angels or demons, they came in and mixed with the daughters of men, they did not get to every family. Noah and his family built the ark, and they stayed pure and true to God, and so the demons failed in their mission to stop the Messiah from being born. A race of giants became the offspring of this unnatural union between these demons and women, so God had to destroy it all and start it back over with Noah and his family. Now we go back to our text. 1 Peter 3, verse 19 and 20. By which also he, Jesus, went and preached unto the spirits in prison, which sometime were disobedient, when once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a-preparing, wherein few, that is, eight souls, were saved by water. They had been rescued in spite of the water, not because of the water. Here, water was the agent of God's judgment, not the means of salvation. The water, the flood water that brought death to those on this earth during Noah's day, brought deliverance to Noah and his family is they're safe in the ark. These disobedient demons tried to stop Jesus from being born of a virgin, but they failed in their mission. And what they did was so awful, God chained them so they could never attempt such a dreadful act again. And to try to mix with these women and corrupt the human race, as all atrocious as that was, and all evil as that was, God said it'll never happen again. So he chained them in a demon dungeon. Now we come back to next. Jesus, he died on the cross as our substitute. He was buried in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathaea. This would have been on Friday when Jesus was buried. He rose from the dead on Sunday. But what happened between Friday and Sunday? Jesus went into that demon dungeon, the Bible said, and preached a message of victory and triumph to those demons. His message, I believe, to these demons was that their devious plan to corrupt the human race did not work. Jesus was born of a virgin. He did live a sinless life. He did go to the cross and die for the sins of humanity. He was buried in the tomb on Friday evening. He would ascend up from the grave on Sunday morning, and he would conquer death, hell, and the grave. Therefore, the message that Jesus preached was a message of victory and success. The plan of Satan did not work, and Jesus, woo, is a wonderful, glorious Savior. Amen and glory to God. That ought to be enough to make a Presbyterian shout. Jesus accomplished this great feat of redemption. Isn't that a great message? That kind of makes you want to charge hell with a squirt gun. Amen. Then the last thing, we're done. The resurrection of Christ. And we're going to get to it a little bit more in detail tomorrow on Easter Sunday morning. But it says in verse number 21 here in 1 Peter 3, the like figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us, not the putting away of filth in the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience towards God by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now baptism here carries the idea of identification. And this is not water baptism. A person cannot be saved by water baptism. You can go down to the creek and be baptized. So many times the tadpoles know your social security number, but it will not wash one sin away. Only the blood of Jesus can do that. But this is identifying with the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And because Jesus rose over death, every saint of God will also rise from the dead, and we're going to have victory in Jesus Christ. Peter is teaching that the fact that 8 people were in the ark and they went through the whole judgment yet unharmed, and that's kind of like the Christian's experience in salvation. We are in Christ, the ark of our salvation. Peter is not at all referring to water baptism. He is rather figuratively talking about our union with Christ, who is our ark of safety from the judgment of God. And the resurrection of Christ demonstrates God's acceptance of Christ's substitutionary death for the sins of all mankind. If you'll believe in it, you'll be saved. Judgment fell on Christ, just as judgment of the floodwaters fell upon the ark. And the believer who is in Christ is thus in the ark of safety, and we will sail over the waters of judgment into eternal glory of heaven. And to be sure, he is not misunderstood. Peter clearly says he's not speaking of water baptism. In Noah's flood, they were kept out of that water, while those who went into the water were destroyed. But being in the ark, they were saved from God's judgment. And friends, this is a symbolic prefigure that we who know Christ, we are in him who is our ark of safety, and we are saved from eternal damnation in hell. And then notice the ascension of Christ. Verse 22 tells us, he has gone into heaven. He is at the right hand of God, and angels and authorities and powers are being made subject unto him. So what we see here, the point of application to Peter's readers is that suffering can be the context for one's greatest triumph, as you see in Jesus. Sometimes God will even use suffering to bring good to us and glory to Him and to help those around us. Now Jesus, He has gone back to heaven. He has been gone over 2,000 years. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He is our great high priest. And when you fall, He is there in the presence of the Heavenly Father. He is praying and interceding for you. And all the angels and authorities and powers, they're all subject to Jesus. That means they're under His authority. Why? He's King of Kings. Woo! And He is Lord of Lords. Glory to God. We serve a risen Savior, and He has conquered death, hell, and the grave. I heard a story that really touched my heart, and it was from a Korean pastor. And during the 4th century AD in Korea, a man had two sons, and the older rose to become the chief justice of the land, and the younger son became a bandit, a thief, a robber. And so he has one good son and one evil son. And so the elder brother, who had actually become the chief justice in the land, he loved his younger brother, even though he was a thief, and he was unable to persuade him to change his ways. Many a day he would try to talk to him. Many a day he would try to get him to change his ways. Eventually the younger son was caught and brought before his father, the chief justice of the land. So everybody in the courtroom thought the younger brother would get off, because it was a well-known fact that his older brother, the chief justice, loved his younger brother dearly. But at the end of the trial, the chief justice sentenced his brother to death. But at that time, on the day of the execution, when the time came for that young brother to die as means of execution for his crime, the elder brother, the chief justice, came to the prison. And he said to his brother, "Let's swap places." And the younger brother agreed, thinking that once they realized that it was the elder brother, the execution would never go forward. So on he went up the hill to watch what the proceedings were going to happen. And he saw as his older brother, who had taken his place, was brought out at dawn. And to his horror, he watched his older brother die in his place. He was so filled with remorse, he couldn't really understand. He didn't think they'd go through with it. He ran down the hill and told the guard his name, and that he was the criminal that should have been crucified or executed. And the guard said to him, "There is no sentence outstanding on anyone with that name." And friends, his older brother had died to set his younger brother free. And in the same way, Christ has died for our sins, so that we who accept His death, burial, and resurrection can be saved from our sins. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for the time again that we can come together and share just another portion of Your word. And Lord, as we think about that time between the death and the resurrection, our Savior was very busy preaching to these spirits in prison a message of victory. They could not stop the virgin birth. Why? It was the plan of God. He saved Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. And through that first son, Shem, we have the Jewish people of which Jesus was born. And He did come through the seed of a virgin called Mary. And He did live a sinless life and died a sacrificial death. Now He's getting ready to rise again, as we're going to see tomorrow. But Lord, I pray for everyone today that You would encourage us, strengthen us. And friends, if you're listening today to the voice of this passage, I want you to put your faith in the Lord. If you've never done that, you can be saved. He took your place like the older brother The righteous brother took the younger brother's place and died for him. Jesus died for you. He died for me. And the Bible promises, whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So if you'd like to ask Jesus to be your Savior, would you pray something like this? Dear Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me for my sins. Save my soul. Make me a home in heaven. Thank you for dying in my place. Help me to live for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, friends, we got one more message tomorrow. And I hope you can tune in as we look at that wonderful resurrection of Christ as we study Matthew chapter 28, the day of all days when Jesus comes back from the dead. Until then, may God richly bless you.